Friends, Christ is risen.
He is risen.
Welcome this morning to Westminster Presbyterian Church. We are so glad that you chose to spend your Easter morning with us. We know that there are many other choices, and so we are so thankful to have you here with us this morning. Friends, we at Westminster Church know that not everyone who walks through our doors might call themselves Christian. We only hope to be Christian to you. And so we are happy and hopeful that you feel welcomed here this morning. We here worship together as a family with kids and adults all together. So please, parents, be at ease. We are happy to have any squirmy children or whispers or any of those things. We are quite comfortable here. And so we are once again glad to have all of you with us this morning. Friends, it is Easter Sunday and the sun is shining. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Let us worship God.
Thank you.
Let us rise for the call to worship.
Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Darkness has become light. Despair has become shouts of joy. Our mourning has become dancing. Our tears have turned to joyful song. Death could not hold him. Fear will not shake us. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed.
Join us in our litany of resurrection. God of terror and joy, you arise to shake the earth. Open our graves and give us back the past. Let all that has been buried in us be freed and forgiven.
Arise in us this day, O God.
Although we fear change, although we are not ready, although we'd rather weep and run away, give us courage to face the future with joy.
Arise in us this day, O God.
In the darkness of our lives, in the sorrow of our deepest grief, as night transforms into joyful dawn,
arise in us this day, O God.
Because you turn folly to wisdom, because you turn death into life, because you give hope where hope is in vain. Arise in us this day, O God. Alleluia. Amen.
Our first reading is Psalm 118, verses 1 to 2 and 14 to 24. Listen for the word of God. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say his steadfast love endures forever. The Lord is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. Hark, glad songs of victory in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. I shall not die, but I shall live and recount the deeds of the Lord. The Lord has chastened me sorely, but he has not given me over to death. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank thee that thou hast answered me and hast become my salvation. The stone which the builders rejected has become the head of the corner. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Friends, it is so good to see so many familiar and wonderful faces here this morning. Thank you for being here. Our gospel lesson for this morning is taken from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 16, verses 1 through 8. Let us listen to God's word to us this morning. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, brought spices so that they might go and anoint Jesus. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. And as they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said, nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Will you pray with me? Holy God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts and the deeds of our hands be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Fear is a powerful emotion. One of the most powerful, perhaps. When we experience it in the depths of our body and mind, it can be wholly paralyzing, heart-stopping, all-consuming. These were some of the thoughts going through my head as I walked briskly back through the woods trying to calm myself down from yelling at my children. I was perhaps excused from my irrational behavior, since fear is such a powerful emotion. It was just a few weeks after we had moved to Connecticut, just a few weeks after the boys had started school. They had taken to spending the hour after school playing in the woods around the fields, making forts and forming secret clubs. It was boy heaven. And I was just beginning to relax into complacency, chatting with the other mothers. And then there was this day when a few too many minutes passed since I had last caught a glimpse of one of my boys through the trees. And then when I started to search for them, one of them was gone. Some of the other boys guessed at where he was, but when I looked, he wasn't there. And I began thinking of every worst thing that could have happened. And then it started. This feeling of nausea and the hot cheeks and the shortened breath, anger, panic, fear. By the time I tracked him down, I was that crazy mother, shouting at her children and then hugging them and then shouting at them again. It was a long walk home as I tried to reconcile my irrational fear with the reality. Everyone was fine. I had had nothing to fear. Fear is a powerful emotion. And every once in a while, there is that moment when the experience of fear takes your breath away. Fear is all over our Easter story, and it is not pretty. By the time we come to this place in Mark's gospel, we have watched in disappointment and disgust as Jesus is arrested and the disciples scatter, as even Peter the rock fearfully denies knowing Jesus not once but three times. Only the women remain following at a distance in dread as they watch their beloved rabbi unjustly tried and beaten and mocked. Even God seems to have run away in fear as Jesus cries out in his forsakenness. And then for 3 days, all is lost, all is dark, all is fear. And then after the Sabbath, very early in the morning, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, they set out with spices to finish the burial rite. Still lost in grief, they are beset with anxiety, wondering how they will get to the body. When they get there, they find the tomb open. and fear turns to confusion. They peer into the dark space, looking for the body, looking for death. And what they see is more alarming than even death. It is the unexpected. It is the incoherent. "Do not be alarmed," the young man robed in white says to them. "You are looking for Jesus. He has been raised. He is not here. But go and tell the others. He is going ahead of you to Galilee. You will see him there." I expect the women felt nauseous. I expect their cheeks flushed with heat. I expect their hearts began racing. Fear, true and total fear. And they fled. Seized by terror and amazement, they ran. They said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. What would you have done? Fear is a powerful emotion. It's what I was thinking as I sat in a circle of parents and teens and listened to all the reasons why we shouldn't be traveling to the border of Arizona and Mexico. It was 3 weeks before we were supposed to depart for our mission trip. I didn't blame them, of course. Just a day prior, we had learned that the town in which we had planned to stay for our week, Agua Prieta, had recently erupted in gang violence. 3 had been killed. Not only that, but that same week, a group of college kids were in Agua Prieta meeting with a nun in her church, and they were surrounded by armed gunmen. It seems that the unmarked white vans that they had parked out front looked suspicious, and the gang members wanted to know who the outsiders were. No one was harmed. The Presbyterian workers spoke with the men, and they left without incident. But fear is a powerful thing. As I listened to my group, I was aware that for us it was a deep privilege to be able to choose whether or not to be around violence, when for the people of Agua Prieta, this was part of their daily life. I wondered if God called us to be even in the midst of violence, even to put our lives at risk to work for reconciliation and justice. But I too wanted to return safely to my boys. I too wanted to be free from fear and suffering. The voices of our youth spoke out. "We knew these risks when we signed up." The parents spoke. "These risks are too great." In the end, we still went to the border, but we stayed and slept in the U.S. And we spent only one day in Agua Prieta. We stayed just miles from where we would have been on the other side of the wall. Fear is a powerful emotion. It is in our nature, fear. It drives almost everything we do. We choose our homes, the cars we drive, our sneakers, the food we eat in response to fear. Where can we go to flee the violence that seems to seep from the grounds in our cities? What can we drive that will protect us from any harm and those people who text when they drive? How can we protect our bodies from twisted ankles and broken bones? How can we assure ourselves that we will be free from illness, free from death? We cling to life because we know it is fleeting. We are afraid because the darkness is real. We know true fear. Not the fear of momentarily lost children, but those losses that are irreparable. The fear that comes with the worst diagnoses, the fear of what is next that follows unimagined grief, the fear that falls like a shadow around addiction and mental illness, the fear that comes with the depths of the unknown. From Iran to Indiana, from Ferguson to Kenya to downtown Hartford, we know fear. And in the face of terror and discrimination, in violence and war, we would just as soon step aside, out of the crosshairs. We are just like those women who fled in silence, just like those men who scattered. In the face of our own fear and amazement, we say nothing to anyone, for we are afraid. This can't be how it ends. For those of you who might have read along, you might be thinking, this isn't how it ends. There are, in fact, two other endings given at the end of Mark, endings that scholars are pretty sure were added to Mark's inconclusive conclusion, endings that tell of resurrection and appearances and sharing of the gospel to the ends of the earth, endings that, well, end well. But that is not where Mark left us. It seems that those of us who long for a joyful conclusion on this Easter Sunday are part of a long tradition of hearers who do not tolerate unfinished stories. Instead, Mark wants to leave us with this faint whisper of timid women. Instead, Mark leaves us where Jesus finds us, in a world where there are no satisfying endings, filled with more questions than answers. And he calls this good news. The truth is, Easter is neither a documentable historical event nor a poetic metaphor for renewal. It is a great mystery of faith. The Easter story cannot be ordered. It is not logical. And yet, perhaps, there is still some good news here. As the women are told, Jesus is not here, he has been raised. Christ cannot be confined by the tomb or limited by death. And the women are left with this promise. Jesus has gone on ahead of you, and he will meet you there. Just as we have seen and experienced, Jesus is always out ahead of us. And if Jesus is on the loose, then we need not fear. If Jesus goes ahead of us, then we can meet the darkness of our lives with confidence, knowing that nothing, nothing, nothing can separate us from the love of God and Jesus Christ. Jesus is on the loose. He stands in parks passing out clothing and food to the homeless. He wanders the oncology unit, whispering prayers and telling jokes. Jesus is on the loose. He walks in the front lines in Selma and Ferguson. He runs into the Twin Towers as they collapse around him. Jesus is on the loose. He kneels in front of a firing squad in Kenya. He holds a sign that says, "Bring back our girls," in Nigeria. Jesus is on the loose. He marches through the streets yelling, "I can't breathe." He opens his shop in Indiana saying, "We welcome all." Jesus goes on ahead of us into the utter darkness of our humanness, our brokenness, our violence, our betrayals, our failures, and says, "I will meet you there with love." Even though we flee in silence and are shrouded in our own doubts and fears, still Jesus is on the loose. Even though we betray and abandon, still Jesus goes on ahead of us. Even though we fail miserably, still Jesus will meet us with joy. Even though by every possible standard we still live in fear and in failure, still Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. The end is just the beginning. Beyond our fears, leading us towards hope and justice, Jesus is on the loose. Look, he is going ahead of you. Will you meet him there? In the name of the Creator and the Christ and the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Amen.
Friends, there is much going on in the life of this congregation. You can read about it in This Week at Westminster, the purple insert in your order of worship. If you are interested in membership, there are inquirers classes on April 19th and 26th in the Covenant Room. You can speak to Julie or myself or email the church office if you are interested. There's many things happening in the missional life of the church as far as food share, walk for hunger, and also a women's habitat build, which is on May 9th. Stacy Rainey will be heading that up, and we will have information about that in the bulletin next week. As we celebrate the risen Christ this day, so we too this week celebrate the lives of two of our members. On Tuesday, we will celebrate the life of Don Estes at 1 p.m. in the sanctuary, and on Friday, the life of Helen McMeekin at 11 a.m. in the sanctuary. This morning, we also keep in prayer June Johnson, who was returned home from Hartford Hospital to Seabury, only to suffer a stroke this morning. While we gathered for worship. So please keep the Sprout family, Howard and Karen and Joanna and June in your prayers, as well as Catherine, Karen's sister. My friends, as we receive our morning offering this morning, I invite you during that time to also lift your prayers to God. As God is gracious to us, so are we gracious to each other. God has given us much, and so we return to God a portion of what we have. Let us receive this morning's offering.
This joyful Easter time, away with sin and song. My God.
Friends, this is the joyful feast of the people of God. And they have come from the north and the south and the east and the west to sit at this table. According to the Gospel of Luke, on the day of the resurrection, the disciples were on the road from Jerusalem, some of them were, and they were headed to Emmaus, and a stranger traveled with them. And they were talking about all the things that had happened. And when they came in for the evening and sat at a table, the stranger took a loaf of bread, and he broke it, saying a blessing. And the disciples' eyes were opened, and they recognized him as the risen Christ. It is Christ who plays host at this table, and he invites all who are welcome to come and eat and partake of this meal, which he has prepared for us, for you, for all. So friends, come this day to the feast of the Lord, for you are welcome here.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Let us pray. It is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise, O God, creator and redeemer of all. Out of your goodness, the world was created for beauty and delight. Out of your great love, we were created in your image. And yet, we are prone to failure, choosing paths of destruction and darkness. You sent prophets to point us the way to you, and yet still we lived in fear and confusion. And then you sent Jesus to teach and show us your ways. He opened his arms wide and embraced the world with his love. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with all the faithful of every time and place, who forever sing to the glory of your name.
Blessed indeed is the one who comes in your name. Blessed is Christ, the baby in Bethlehem, the boy of Nazareth, the rabbi of the 12, the Son of God, who came in the power of your name and the nature of your love. Blessed indeed is the courage by which he died and the choice by which he lived. Remembering his life, his teachings, accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, as a living and holy offering of ourselves, that our lives may proclaim the one crucified and risen. Great is the mystery of faith.
Gracious and loving God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of grain and grape, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body of Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, that we may be one with all who share this feast. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world.
Thank you.
Holy God, may the risen one stand among us, speaking your words of peace, releasing us from our fears, healing us from our wounds, keeping us faithful in your service until his final victory, when all shall feast with you and all your saints in the joy of your eternal realm. This we pray in the name of the risen Christ, who taught us to boldly pray these words together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
And friends, we remember together that on the night before he died, Jesus sat at a table with those who chose, those who dared to follow him. And he took a loaf of bread, the common stuff of life. And after giving thanks to God, he blessed it and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
And afterwards, he took a cup. And after giving thanks, he gave it to them. And he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant, given for you for the forgiveness of sins. For as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim my saving death until I come again. For this is the bread and the cup of life. For you are the people of life." Friends, these are the gifts of God for you, the people of God.
This is a sign of God's love for you. Jeremy, this is a sign of God's love for you.
Thank you.
Let us join together in prayer.
Nourished at this table, O Lord, may we know Christ's redemptive love and live a new life in him. Help us to recognize our Lord in the breaking of the bread, to see and serve him in all whose lives are broken. Give us who are fed at his hand grace to share our bread with the hungry of heart. United with all those who walk the way of Christ, may we work for the reconciliation of the world. We pray in the name of the risen Christ. Amen.
Places of the world, go bring the good news. It is needed. And now, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you and bring you peace today and forevermore. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us share that peace with one another.